Welcome back. Now it's time for our daily press review, and we are delighted to be joined here in the studio with Mrs. Iqbal Mahmoud. She's a news editor. Good morning, Mrs. Iqbal.
Good morning.
And we start off as usual from Al Ahram newspaper, and we read its main banner. We are aiming to achieve integration with the Nile Basin countries. Preserving the interests of everyone would achieve development without any harm to any party. In his meeting with the Kenyan parliamentarian delegation, Al-Sisi highlights the importance of working to increase the revenues of the River Nile and make good use of it. President Abdel-Fattah Al-Sisi receives a delegation of Kenya's Parliament Defense and Foreign Relations Committee headed by MP Andongo Jitani. During the meeting, the president tackles the importance of working on increasing and making use of the Nile resources through joint cooperation and on the basis of mutual benefit. So, Mrs. Iqbal, how can we enhance cooperation with the Nile Basin countries, and what is the significance of this visit by the Kenyan delegation?
Well, of course, the problem is very critical now. Yes. And we have to start our negotiations on the basis of mutual interests and benefits.
Yes.
We should give the Ethiopian part some sort of benefits in order to reach some settlement, because this is vital here in Egypt.
Yes. And in general, how can we enhance cooperation with Nile Basin countries in general? Economic cooperation,
exactly.
Political cooperation.
We would open markets. Economy, yes. Economy and finance,
yes.
That's the main base ground,
yes.
When it comes to interests, mainly.
And how do you evaluate Egypt's foreign policy when it comes to African countries? Do you feel that there is a significant change in its policy towards African countries, especially after the election of President?
There is a rise.
Yes.
There is a rise. We are on the rise,
yes.
Right now. But of course, it was neglected quite a long,
yes.
Time ago, and for quite some time. Mm-hmm. And so we need to exert much more effort,
yes.
To regain our position as a leading African country.
Yes. Yeah. And still with Al Ahram, and from page 4, we read more local news. Al-Sisi tackles with the government the national project for drinking water and sewage. Today, the government starts to pay the compensations of the farmers who were affected from the heavy rain that hit both Alexandria and Bahira. The president agrees to allocate £2 billion to urgently solve the problem of the rainwater in the different governorates. The president checks on the process of work of the committee assigned to provide commodities and gives his instruction that work should start in the markets by the beginning of next month. And still with the same issue which made the main banner in Al-Akhbar, and we read Al-Sisi asks the government about its preparations for the upcoming rain wave. £1 billion for the sewage in the governorates and starting to compensate the farmers today. Al-Sisi says more £1 billion from the budget to solve the problem of rain in the governorates. Madbouli said executing the national project for sewage in two phases. And Mughazi says developing the lifting stations in the Delta area by March. And still with the same issue, and from Al-Masri Al-Youm, we read its main banner. The government prepares a detailed report to present to the next parliament. The president tackles with its main facing the upcoming wave of rain and the distribution of commodities. So now, how do you evaluate the government handling of this crisis and preparations for the coming wave of rain?
Two other pressing issues here,
yes.
in Egypt. The society is facing the rains and the prices, soaring prices and the rains.
Yes.
And so it's good to start a little bit early. We should have started earlier, actually.
Yes.
But it's good. Better late than never.
Yes.
So it's much better. And it's good that everyone should bear his and her responsibility. The government, the people, they should also learn how to behave and how to face such problems.
Also, President Al-Fatah Sisi gave directives for the allocation of 2 billion Egyptian pounds to renew and to develop the sewage drainage system in Alexandria.
Yes.
So now we can see that there is prompt and swift actions taken by the government
yes.
in handling crisis.
That's good. As I've said, better late
yes.
than never. It's good. We said last week that our infrastructure here in Egypt is collapsing.
Yes.
Unfortunately, it is, and we have to face that.
Yes, because we have a rising population.
Exactly.
And the
people, they don't really know how to handle such problems. I think this is the first time in Egypt to have some people drowning
yes.
because of some heavy rains.
Yes.
Still, they are rains, not torrential
right.
rains.
And back to Al-Ahram from page N, we read at the end of the conference that tackled renewing the religious discourse, calling for an international Islamic body to face extremism. And the guests of the conference visit the monuments of the upper Egyptian city of Luxor. The High Council for Islamic Affairs concludes its meeting in Luxor in the opening session on Saturday. The head of the most prestigious Islamic institution, Al-Azhar, condemned the hateful attacks on Paris and urged global unity against extremism. And still with the same issue and from Al-Akhbar newspaper, we read a tour of Luxor monuments for the guests of the Supreme Council of the Islamic Affairs. The Islamic Affairs Conference in Luxor calls for the drawing the resources of terrorism. Gomez says preaches should only be delivered by experts and preventing those with extremist ideas from communicating with the television channels. Grand Imam of Al-Azhar, Sheikh Ahmed Al-Tayyib, denounces the Paris attacks, stressing that the time has come for the world to unite to confront terrorism. Al-Tayyib stresses that such acts are contrary to all religions and humanitarian and moral principles. So, how do you see the role of different religious institutions now in combating tourism, and to what extent such a conference can help in combating this phenomenon?
I hope it would help, but to start with, we've been saying repeatedly on and on and on, terrorism is a global phenomenon. It has nothing to do with religions,
yes.
it has nothing to do with nationalities,
yes.
it is not related to one certain religion, between quotations, Islam,
yeah.
it is not related to the Arab world. No, it's not.
Mm.
If those involved in such attacks are Arabs, but still, the arms they get, they are not made in the Arab world.
Mm.
So, I think Al-Azhar and other Islamic institutions should address the international community more openly and should work harder. They should prove that it's not just by saying and repeating, no, Islam has nothing to do with terrorism, Islam's calls for cooperation, for mercy, for respecting human rights. We should prove this. And one main and important and the main condition to combat terrorism is to reinstate justice and the values of respecting human rights
yes.
everywhere.
And back to Al-Ahram newspaper, and we read from its front page, Egyptians unite with France against terrorism. The clues of the Paris crime revealed gradually the finger of Mustafawi proves his involvement and arresting six of his relatives and discovering a car police suspects it was used in the attack. Paul says, we are facing a war and we shall strike the enemy in France, Europe, Syria and Iraq. The capital of light had an appointment with terrorism once again, and the French opposition calls for urgent measures. Still with the same issue from Al-Akhbar from page, and we read, France declares war on Daesh. The death of 20 foreigners, include 5 Arabs, in Paris attacks. And Iraq says, we have warned France. Sarkozy calls for changing France's foreign policy and for cooperating with Russia. Israel calls on Europe to ignore human rights for the sake of security. So now we'll have a report on this tragic accident and more about the reactions of world leaders. So stay tuned.
Pyramid in Egypt was covered on Sunday in French, Lebanese and Russian colors in homage to the victims of the attacks in Paris and Beirut and the Sinai plane crash. The Great Pyramid of Khufu, the only one of the seven wonders of the ancient world still standing, was illuminated by projectors reproducing the flags of France and Russia and the green cedar of Lebanon. Young Egyptians were staging an overnight candlelit vigil at the foot of the more than 4,500-year-old giant monument on the Giza Plateau on the outskirts of Cairo. The Tourism and Antiquities Ministries organized the ceremony to mourn the innocent lives lost around the world, paying tribute to the victims of the crash of the Russian plane and attacks in Lebanon and France. Late on Friday, gun and bomb attacks in Paris, claimed by the Daesh group, killed 132 people and wounded 352. On Thursday in Beirut, twin bombings, claimed by Daesh, killed 44 people in southern Beirut. Meanwhile, in Dubai, the world's tallest building, the Burj Al Khalifa, was lit up on Sunday in the colors of the French national flag. Elsewhere in the Gulf, Kuwait City's landmark towers were also illuminated in the red, white, and blue of France.
Back to you, Mrs. Kobel, and we were talking about international reactions regarding a tragic incident that took place on Friday in France. So how do you read international reactions?
Well, of course, they are ringing the bells.
Yes.
Okay. But again, we would say that it is a global phenomenon.
Yes.
A day or two later, Beirut was struck.
Yes.
So one in Europe, one in the Middle East.
But how do you read this rise in attacks in the past week? The Russian plane and that. And then what happened?
Definitely, successive events were stepping up.
Yes.
Hastily, yes. And I don't know, but it is very fishy and it rings the bells.
Yes.
Yeah, you find first the plane, the Russian plane, then the other plane that fell, that crashed in the Sudan.
Yes.
And then the Paris attacks.
In Lebanon.
And then Lebanon. Yes. Exactly. So things are hastening.
Yes. Crazy.
Yes, exactly. It's a crazy world. Mm. It is running crazy.
And still with the same issue, and from Al Masri Al Youm front page, we read revealing the identity of the first suicide bomber in the Paris attacks. A European net carried out the attacks and an arrest campaign in France and Belgium. French prosecutor François Molland announces that at least three French suicide bombers were involved in the deadly attacks on Paris, which killed 132. This as the probe into the assault spread across Europe and as French police released a photograph of a dangerous suspect wanted over the attacks. Now we'll have a report on the investigations and the attack that took place in Paris.
French warplanes pounded Daesh positions in Syria on Sunday. This as police in Europe widened their investigations into coordinated attacks in Paris that killed 132 people. Daesh has claimed responsibility for Friday's suicide bombings and shootings, which have reignited a row over Europe's refugee crisis and drawn calls to block a huge influx of asylum seekers. French police have launched an international hunt for a Belgian-born man they believe helped organize the assaults with two of his brothers. A further two French suicide attackers have been identified, while the identity of four other assailants who all died in the violence was still under review. France has been bombing Daesh positions in Iraq and Syria for months as part of a U.S.-led operation. Following Friday's attacks, Paris vowed to destroy the Daesh group. Underlining its resolve, French jets on Sunday launched their biggest raids in Syria to date, hitting Daesh's stronghold in Arraqa.